Books on Tape presents The Crazyladies of Pearl Street by Trevanian. Read by Leonardo Leoncavallo. Author's note. Although the characters and incidents of this novel are set in a closely observed and carefully described block of Albany, New York, during the Great Depression and the Second World War, a lively desire to thwart the litigious impulses for which Americans have become renowned obliges me to declare that all the characters and names are products of my imagination and exist in no other reality than my own. The Green Cake. My sister, my mother, and I sat in a row on the front stoop of 238 North Pearl Street, feeling overwhelmed and diminished by the unfamiliar bustle of the big city. Beside the stoop was a stack of twine-bound cardboard boxes bulging with bedding, clothing, and kitchen things. Around them were clustered our few scraps of furniture, looking scuffed and shabby in the unforgiving glare of daylight. It was St. Patrick's Day, and the mid-March sun felt good, but chill winter air still lurked in the shadows. The year was 1936. I was 6 years old. My sister was 3. My mother was 27. And we were beginning a new life. We had been sitting on that stoop long enough for the gritty brownstone to mottle the backs of my legs between my short pants and my knee-high stockings. My sister wore a starched, frilly dress that Mother had bought out of money meant to tide us over until we got on our feet, because she wanted Anne-Marie to look pretty the first time her father saw her. But the dress had got crushed during the long drive with the three of us crammed into half of the front seat of my uncle's rattletrap of a truck. And now we sat hip to hip on that step, Mother in the middle, my sister and I drawing comfort from contact with her, while she drew maternal strength and determination from contact with us. Anne-Marie was hungry and sleepy and close to tears. Taking her onto her lap, Mother looked anxiously up and down the street for my father, whom she hadn't seen for 4 years, not since the morning he went out to look for work and didn't come back, leaving her with a toddler, a baby, and $2 and some change in her purse. She didn't hear from him again until a letter arrived just 3 days earlier, saying how sorry he was for running away from the family he loved, the family he had worried about every single minute since he left. There was no excuse for behaving like that, he admitted, but he just couldn't stand being made to feel he wasn't man enough to support his own wife and children. He had been sure that her family would give us a hand once he was out of the picture. He knew that Mother's father considered him to be little better than a flashy hustler and a con man, exactly what he was, in fact. The letter said that he had found a job and an apartment in Albany. Not much of a job and not much of an apartment, but it would be a start, and he had something big in the works. That letter had come in the nick of time because the owner of Lake George Village's only all-year restaurant had just told my mother that he wouldn't be needing her as a waitress when the tourist season began. Her frequent absences during that winter when she was sick with lung trouble had shown him that she was unreliable, and he had decided to replace her. During the whole trip down to Albany, my uncle had grumbled about the time and money this was costing him, and when we didn't find my father waiting at the address he had given us, my uncle just unloaded our stuff in grumpy haste and left us there, saying that he had to make it back before nightfall because he didn't trust the headlights of his old truck. He was in such a hurry to get away that he drove off without shutting the passenger side door, which flopped open. As he reached over to shut it, he stepped on his brakes, causing the door to pinch his hand. He roared a curse as he furiously stomped on the gas to get the hell away from that goddamn hole of a goddamn slum. But the truck stalled, and a car behind him sounded its irritated horn. So he shouted at the driver to go to hell and started up again, and he drove off pounding his good fist on the steering wheel, glad to see the end of his wife's goddamn freeloading cousin and her goddamn brats. Mother and I exchanged glances and couldn't help smiling. My father's letter had said that we should wait for him on the steps of the building because he was planning a big surprise for us. But now Mother was tired of sitting there with people peering at us from windows and stoops all around. She rose to go inside and look for him, but I grabbed her wrist. Like most kids, I loved surprises, and I didn't want her to ruin this one. Let's wait just a little while longer. A couple of boys detached themselves from a knot of kids and sauntered past our stoop, disdainfully eyeing our cardboard boxes and our shoddy furniture, then letting their sassy eyes slide over me. I knew that my short pants and knee socks made me an object of scorn to these two boys dressed in knickers. From school, I was familiar with those universal rituals among boys when they puppy-sniff one another for the first time, measuring and hefting for rank and dominance. I could tell that the smaller of the two boys, a big-eared kid about a year older than I, was wondering if this skinny new kid would turn out to be a regular guy or a sissy, if I would fight my way out of schoolyard challenges or run to the teachers. I kept my eyes on him as he strolled by, but I held him in a soft, tired look. To look hard-eyed would be to send a challenge. To avoid his eyes would be to submit. Boys are born with this canine pack hunter's instinct for cast and nipping order. After the kids had passed, one of them crossed the street and spoke to a flat-faced, boneless woman sitting on her stoop, obviously his mother. And I could see she was asking him about us, especially about my mother, who wasn't anything like the faded marshmallow mothers of other kids. My mother was young and slim and had short, bobbed hair. She could dance and run and play games, and she wore slacks in an era when few women did. I don't know what the kid said, but his mother sniffed in a way that was both competitive and dismissive. I was used to that sort of reaction to my mother, but still sensitive about it. It wasn't that I wanted her to be the same as other mothers. I was proud of her youthful good looks and her feisty independence, but I sometimes wished she could be different in a less obvious way, because it's hard having a mother who's different. Some bigger boys, 14 or 15 years old, loitered in front of a corner store diagonally across the street from our stoop. Fully aware of the gaggle of girls who admired them from two stoops away and whom they ostentatiously ignored, the boys talked loudly, pushed one another in gruff play, snorted out forced laughs, and repeatedly glanced at their reflections in the corner store window with satisfaction, although now and then one of them felt obliged to hook a comb out from his back pocket and drag it through his brill-creamed hair, then press the sides into place with a caressing palm. They played an endless round-robin of that finger game in which paper covers rock, rock smashes scissors, and scissors cut paper, known by different names in various parts of the country, but called Rochambeau in the urban Northeast by generations of kids who had no idea that a French general who had helped our infant republic defeat the British at Yorktown had been immortalized in a child's game, much less how to spell the chanted sound as they threw their fingers out on the bow of the third syllable. The loser of Rochambeau had to let the winner knuckle him, hit him on the top of the head as hard as he wanted to with the knuckle of his middle finger. The one who got knuckled would snort disdainfully, although the pain sometimes dampened his eyes with fugitive tears, which he quickly blinked away as he rearranged his hair in the store window. Two of the boys were smoking. The biggest one, who was the leader, and a small ugly one who played the role of flunky and clown. They smoked like kids new to smoking do, trying to appear supremely casual, but fussily examining the burning ends of their cigarettes with grave frowns and tapping off the ash more frequently than it could gather. These older boys wore long trousers and were bareheaded, while the younger boys of the block were in knickerbockers and caps. Only very young boys wore short pants, except for me, of course. The principal bane of my life was my mother's need to dress my sister and me better than other kids, in compensation, I suppose, for our lack of a father and a secure breadwinner. Because she couldn't afford new clothes, the hand-me-downs my sister and I wore were always cleaner and more freshly ironed than those of our playmates. Yet another of those differences that kids will not endure. The strange new sounds and gestures of life and play that I observed with a mixture of fascination and malaise from our stoop that first afternoon would, In the course of the 8.5 years I was to live on North Pearl Street, become the unremarkable and unremarked ambience of my block, with its noise, its squalor, its childhood rites and ordeals, the awkward rutting rituals of its adolescence, and its shoals of dirty brats with runny noses, nits, and impetigo, playing their screaming games of kick the can or stick ball, sassing icemen and pushcart vendors, blocking traffic, and exchanging insults with truck drivers who wanted to get through. On that first day, the game of stickball in the middle of the street broke up when second base drove off.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.